And it's my pleasure to tell this afternoon session about the kind of physics. And I think it will be as exciting as the football, the soccer. We just get home. And the further good news for those who are disappointed is that on Saturday you probably have a chance to see me during the meeting in England in soccer. Saturday is the okay, so Saturday. Good. So we will have three contributions now. The first one is invited talk by Ioannis and Rousochatzakis. And this is about quantum spin liquid in the semi-classical regime. So please.
Thank you very much. I would like to thank the organizers for the opportunity to present our talk here. This is work done in collaboration with Yuri Institute and it's about a very unusual state of matter, which is the quantum field addressing a system with a very large quantum number of spin S. And I'm going to start by telling you why this is very unusual. So we have already quite a lot about quantum liquids, like in the tutorial session on Monday. It's about the wave functions that are described by massive superpositions of product-like states. And this statement has to be true for any choice of basis, otherwise you don't get coordination development. And the standard example is the electromagnetic body concept that was introduced by Anderson 10 years ago. The example that I will be focusing on will appear below. Is that of the so-called toy code, which can be described as a superposition in terms of states that are that have loops of red spins pointing to the left in the background of blue spins pointing to the right. And from this basic structure of quantum liquid, it's clear that quite generally one needs two basic ingredients to realize these functions. One is you need, first of all, an extensive number of states with very low energy in a variational sense. And you need some strong resonance mechanism in order to give rise to the superposition. And both these ingredients are typically can be found in highly energy systems with very low spin S. So why is it unusual to have a quantum liquid at very large S or moderate S? To understand this, the simplest way is to go to the classical limit. Suppose that we have a system that has a ground state degeneracy with an extensive number of states. And now if we want to understand the effect of quantum mechanics, what we can do, we can take this manifold of states and we can make a variational basis and we can project the Hamiltonian and do quantum mechanics. And that will give us a matrix. That matrix will have two types of matrix elements. One is a diagonal and the other is off-diagonal. The diagonal represents the potential energy, which is in general different for each type, for each different configuration. By semi-classical expansion. And then there are the off-diagonal elements, and these represent tunneling between different classical states, and we all know that for large S, this is usually a very small number of exponential states. So for large S, degeneracy is limited by potential energy, because potential energy always wins, and this is also called order by the solid effect. As an example, this is a large S, and I can't go back to the model. Now, the alternative scenario that I will present here is that of a system that has local conservation laws. And according to Elliott's theorem, we know that these local symmetries cannot take down potentially. What happens in this case is that potential energy cannot lift the degeneracy, the ending degeneracy. And tunneling will come in and will give rise to the superposition. Okay, the model that I have in mind is a Kitaev model of the quantum lattice. Now, the difference is that it's not spinor half, but some large number S. You already heard what this model is about. Now, the local symmetries that we need in this model, this were introduced in this seminal work by Gaspar and Sanders in 2008. These are basically generalization of the so-called Kitaev packet operator. You basically have a packet of 6 bits. For each packet, you have this two-fold rotation around x, y, z, x, y, z. And for spinor half, this reduces to Kitaev operator. Okay, the following, I will just take the negative k. Case, the positive K can be obtained from the negative case by some kind of graphical simulation, so I don't need to focus on that one. Okay, so I just passed the enough number to finish all the slides. So the main important result is that the logic description of this model is described not in terms of spin sets, but in terms of pseudo spins 1/2, which I will call the event volume. These eta variables, they seem from the bonds of the conical superlattice. These are the yellow bonds. And this superlattice makes translations. The dynamics of these eta variables is precisely that of the so-called Torico, which I will show you before. And the ground states are described as into spin liquid, and you have two types of degeneracy. You have topological degeneracy, and you also have the degeneracy associated with single degeneracy. On top of that, you have two types of excitation gaps. You have the so-called magnetic flux, which will be scaled linearly with the spin S, and you have the so-called electric charge, which will be scaled exponentially with S. I will also show that the description breaks down around 3/2, and I will also make a prediction for spin 1. And, okay, so let's start from the classical manifold. You have infinite ground states. There are different parameterizations. The one I will show here is the one we use in our paper. Basically, you put the spins on each side along some direction, A, I, B, I, C, I. And then you put the following constraint on each bond. Let's say this is a Z bond. You make the Z components equal to each other. If this is an X bond, you make the X components equal to each other. If this is a Y bond, you make the Y components. So this is the constraint that you have. And it seems to see that the energy contribution from these three types of bonds is the square of A0, square of B0, square of C0. You get, because of this spin length constraint, you get constant. This happens to saturate the low energy bound. So these are the ground states. And on the lattice, with the constraints, this gives rise to a very rich structure with algebraic correlation as shown in this slide. So now we're going to add quantum mechanics. And the first thing we're going to look at is the potential energy. And the first type of the leading term that we get in fluctuations is this cubic anisotropy, which is the fourth power of each component. And in order to minimize that contribution, you basically have to select cubic axis, that is, one of the three components has to be one, and the other has to be two, the other two have to be zero. And this is now a random configuration along the cubic axis. Each pin points along one of the three axes. And each of these eta variables is plus or minus 1. And the only constraint is that along the X bonds, the X components have to match. Along the Y bonds, for example, or along the Z bonds here, the Z components have to match and so on. So now you see that this matching condition gives rise to dimers. You can do the dimer whenever you have a matching condition. And this is a dimer configuration. So all these things can be mapped to dimer currents. You can put the eta variables on top of the dimer currents. And now what this dimer, this eta variable represents is basically the two states of the eta variable. If it is plus 1, it means that you take from the two spins involved, you take the plus S and the plus S components of the spin. If it is minus 1, you get minus S and minus S components of the spin. So from two S plus 1 squared states per bond, you keep only two states. And then there are like the number of dimer coming, which is extensive, the number of size, and then for each dimer you have two this theta degree of freedom, so this gives rise to an exponential number, exponentially large number, so-called Cartesian ground states. Okay, then there is a so-called selection of dimer pattern. If you look more carefully at the spin wave corrections to the energy, the result obtained from this paper here is that spin waves propagate along empty loops. That is loops that don't have dimers, and this is such a loop. This is also true that in interacting spin wave theory. The second result is that the shortest loop have the lowest zero point energy correction. So what the system wants to do is maximize the number of shortest loops, and the way to do that is by forming this dimer configuration, where you dimerize the lattice, and you have these shaded hexagons of loops. Okay, but now on top of this, once you freeze this dimer pattern, you still have the eta variables on top of each dimer, which can be plus or minus 1/2. And these eta variables sit on the bonds of the conical superlattice shown here by the dashed lines. Okay, what is now not realized before is that this dimer freezing comes with a topological tenor. The easiest way to see this is by introducing a local frame for each different size. So here we have six sizes. I'm not going to show this transformation here, but what happens is that the interhexagon interaction, like for example S1, S10 here, which is, will map SW, SW. W is the direction of the classical configuration. But the intrahexagon terms, they map as follows: U, V, V, U, U, V, V, U, U, and minus V, P, V, V. So this P, V is the product of the six eta variables surrounding this given hexagon. So you see that however you want to do it, for example, like semiclassical expansion in terms of spin waves, you will get a theory of bosons. And these numbers will appear in this theory. So what happens is that potential energy will be a function of these numbers, of this set of numbers. So if you have different states, if you have states that have the same flash pattern, you will get the same potential energy. So the infinite degeneracy still remains to all orders in semiclassical. So from this general expression, you can imagine that the leading term is a linear in UP. This is basically the so-called magnetic term of the curve out. Some of you may be familiar with it. Okay, now we're going to include quantum mechanical tunneling. So we use potential energy, now we include tunneling. This was the potential energy, basically we can promote the eta variables to Pauli matrices. So this beta, this B term is basically the product of the Z Pauli matrices. The tunneling sits on these vertices of the superphonical lattice, and it involves the product of X components of the Pauli matrix. And this is the so-called electric charge term. If you do the quantum kind of time, you will see that this is precisely the leading term that you get from the perturbation theory. So connecting these two leading terms, you get the so-called Korekov Hamiltonian, which have these two terms. And it's important to mention that so far without the tunneling, it's only the bracket, this W operator that I mentioned at the beginning, the local symmetry is only going to find for these hexagons, it's not going to find for these hexagons. But if you include tunneling, then that symmetry will be stopped. And this is the way that symmetry that tends to appear in this side of the end. Okay, we can calculate these couplings as a function of S as different methods, like the linear spin wave theory, non-linear spin wave theory, or another method based on exact normalization. And what we find is that the magnetic couplings case must be linear with S for large S, and the electric couplings case exponential is to. Okay, so you have, for those of you who are not familiar with the model, basically if both JM and J are negative, what the system wants to do, it wants to have B equal to 1 and A equal to 1 for all vertices and for all brackets. And the way to do this is precisely by this wave function that I showed before. You can easily see that if you look at this vertex here, and you take the product of the X operators, you will find plus 1. And likewise, if you calculate this B operator, then this one, for example, mounts this one. Since you have plus one, you get the same function. Okay, then you also have the so-called topological degeneracy. For example, you have a Gaussian geometry, you get four such constraints in the system. Excitations are fractionalized. The simplest way to see this, you take a psi here, and you apply the Z, eta Z operator, and this will create. Because this eta Z operator is shared by two vertices, you will take two A minus one charges. And likewise, you can apply the eta X operator, and that will give you two B minus one classes of these neighboring packets. And you see that you do a single spin flip, and you get two particles and not one particle. The important thing here, if this thing is to work, is that these particles are, you can take them apart from each other without paying any energy. And this you can actually see in this model explicitly by calculation. You can take, for example, distance of two flashes, you can calculate the energy as a function of distance, and you can see that, you know, that the flashes prefer to be next to each other, but otherwise, very quickly, they saturate some number, and you saturate, so you don't get any energy to take them apart. So that's the phenomenon of triple timing. Okay, so that's like almost the last slide. The overall picture for the energy spectrum is the following. Without the tunneling, you only have potential energy contributions, but you get all infinite ways to have P, B, plus 1 on each bucket. And however you do the perturbation period, all orders to one rest, you will never split this as I mentioned in the beginning. If you add the tunneling, you will leave the degeneracy, you will get the four-fold topological degeneracy, and then you have the two JE charge gap this thing has to be copied three times because you have three ways to choose the where to put the hexagons. So you get the 12-fold degeneracy at the end of the day. Then there is this energy scale, which is twice JM, which is linear in S. This is the excitations with two fluxes. And now, as I said, the excitation energy depends on the distance, but not so much, as I showed in the previous slide. Okay, and now, where does this semi-classical mixture break down? How this happens? So here, what I'm showing is two curves. This is the so-called freezing energy scale, delta EF. The freezing energy scale is basically the energy difference of two diamond coverings. This is the diamond covering that has the shortest loops, and this is the diamond covering that has the longest loops, and this is the typical representative of this energy scale. How much energy you gain if you have this pattern that everything depending on getting the previous slides. And this curve here, the blue curve, is the so-called tunneling of diamonds. So what happens is that the following, you know, as you decrease S, but it happens that you can tunnel directly the diamonds, not just the echo variables, but the positions of the diamonds. So you can go from this position to this position, and you can have this experiment, and you can see that it grows small S as expected. And you can calculate that. And then you can see that, around 3/2, this semi-classical distributor that I described before breaks down. So below 2, you have two kinds of distributor. You have the diamond positions, and you also have on top of each diamond, you have the echo variables. And now I can make the prediction for spin 1, which remains to be proved numerically. Is that for spin 1, you see the dominant energy scale is the tunneling, precisely this tunneling, and we know from quantum diamond models of the Horicon lattice, if you have this tunneling dominant, then you get this resonating Mollison crystal where the diamonds resonate between the blue and the yellow positions. And now on top of this resonating Mollison crystal, which also makes the resonance the same way as the previous one, you have the echo variables that also resonate because of the tunneling curve. So this is a more complicated type of quantum spin liquid. I'm not sure if it's lost the Torrey code, some copies of the Torrey code. But this is basically proved numerically. According to this simple consideration, that seems to be the case. Yeah. Thank you very much for your attention.
Some correlations with the
apply physics, but I think these properties have a lot of similarity with optics, so one has to see an issue wise how much time you have there. But there are many other proposals for modern decay now in the emulating the Kitaev model, and some of them even with streamlining the top. So there are efforts in that direction. For the Donetsk system,